Hello and welcome to The Big Fight. This has been a particularly disturbing week, but perhaps not one that should surprise any of us. Me Too allegations continuing to come out. A number of people, number of women speaking out, speaking about it. And at the same time, you have a situation where a lot of very powerful, strong people whose reputation, could be whatever it has been, have been named in this. Now, a couple of things come out right away in this entire issue. Number one, there should be no question about the fact that any act of sexual predation, anybody who's a sexual predator, who's harassing others, who's harassing his employees, it is something which is wrong. There can be no excuse for it. There should be no justification of it. Anybody who's been guilty of that behavior in the past should be caught, should be punished, and should be hauled up. I think that's something which almost goes without saying. By the way, that's also true if any male has been harassed by any point, and we have seen some harrowing examples coming up of sexual abuse, even of men, so that also goes without saying. But I think what we should try and spend the next 1 hour doing is trying to also look at what lies ahead. Yes, Me Too allegations will continue, a lot more people will be named, and they will hopefully get punishment of some sort or the other. But I think we should also use this to chart a course, to try and figure out how we should be handling ourselves in the future. What is the roles that we should follow? What is the code of conduct that we should follow at the workplace? What is the code of conduct that we should follow with our friends and colleagues who may be of the opposite sex? How do we conduct ourselves in relationship? Because not all the Me Too allegations that we have heard so far have been following the traditional path of a boss harassing a subordinate or a junior or a colleague. Yes, there have been cases of that as well. But many of them are other sort of cases. Somebody who was with somebody else, a boyfriend or a girlfriend, or somebody who met someone at a party or was encountered and then was treated in a particularly obnoxious manner. Yes, that is sexual harassment too. So how do we conduct ourselves in all of those relationships? I'm going to try, and we have a large group of young people with us today, and they all are having that same question. And by the way, I've been asked that question repeatedly over the last 5 or 6 days by a large number of people. What is your advice? What should we do in a company? How do we run a company? How do we conduct ourselves? Now, obviously, the first thing is a very simple, obvious one. Treat those who work for you with respect. And if you've got a female colleague, treat her with absolute and complete respect. She works for you. It is wrong to make a pass at her. I mean, these things are so obvious, they should not merit repetition, but that's the first. What else we should do? Well, let's try and find out from the panel that we've got. And we've got a great, great, great panel joining us. Sushant Singh is joining us in just a couple of minutes, General Secretary of Cinta, really taking a look at what's been happening in the movie industry, which has been at the center of a lot of this. Flora Saini joining us, actors, come out with her own story just a short while back. Bachi Karkaria joining us from Mumbai, been a veteran in the media, and would be very concerned about some of the reports that we've seen coming out from journalistic circles as well, as indeed would M.K. Venu, founding editor of The Wire, who's here. We do have Geeta Luthra also to join us to tell us a little bit about the law in this and how it should work. Ashwajit Singh is Vice Chairman and Managing Director of IPE Global Limited, a company which has actually done a fairly extensive gender audit and to try and get some rules in this. And it's great to have joining us Sandhya Menon, who actually I think deserves a round of applause from all of us, Sandhya, for really taking this on, bringing the issue out and staying with it until to some extent it has completely captured the national attention. And today, as we hear more and more stories coming out, Sandhya, I just want to get you in very briefly on this. I do have Indra Jaisingh also. But to some extent, you've got to wonder, with so many stories coming out, why did it take so long for Me Too to come out? So I'm sure you've also thought about that. Why did it need you, Sandhya, and the others who've been really brave in the last few weeks to stay at it for all of this to really... How was it allowed to continue for so long? Sandhya, you have a take on that?
Are you asking me why it took so long?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, why did it take so long for all of this garbage to come out?
Okay, Okay, I think it's mostly because none of us really, I think at the base of everything is the fact that none of us has any faith in due process. From filing an, okay, forget going out and filing an FIR, but just going up to your HR and saying, hey, this happened to me, and then being talked out of it, or it getting lost in the company machinery, or even if you don't make a formal complaint to HR, telling your senior, and they'll be like, ah, he's just like that. Most women have no idea where to take their complaints. What is the system of redressal? Nobody knows. At least you know, but you aren't sure it'll work for you. And then you're just socialized to believing that this is something that you have to take in your stride. But in the last year, right from Tarana Burke's thing in the US and how it started out to Raya's list, it's just stayed so fertile in our mind. It's not run out of news cycles. I mean, it's been fresh, and it's laid a ground for us to revisit our own stories. And I can tell you that for myself, as well as several women that I've spoken to, we've just gone back and revisited our stories, not just our stories of harassment and the trauma that so many of us have faced, but also how we reacted to it and what we did about it. Some of us have gone back and said, I wish I'd done differently. Some of us have felt guilty. So I think all of that just came to an emotional crescendo right now. And with just a few of us sort of saying, you know, we don't have any more dams to give. It's sort of,
yeah,
the dam broke is the way I see it.
The dam broke and a lot of it has come out, and I have a feeling a lot more is still going to come out. So we'll keep waiting and watching for this, and I guess that's the way it should be. I think it is important, and to help everyone understand what is right and what is wrong beyond the obvious. It shouldn't require anybody to tell you in a TV studio or anywhere else that it's wrong to sexually assault somebody or rape somebody or call somebody to your house and assault them. That's so obvious it doesn't merit repetition. So I think on this program, I would like to look a little bit at the areas which are slightly grey, which is where people would be somewhat confused. Well, what should I do in this case? Again, repeating, if somebody's assaulted you, there's no grey area there. It's wrong. Take action. The person should go to be arrested, thrown behind bars. That's it. It's as simple as that. Flora, I want to get you in on this, because sometimes sexual harassment, the entire question of sexual harassment, is considered a workplace issue. And that may be where it started off. Certainly, Vishakha guidelines and the rest of it are all structured a little bit around workplace issues. Your own instance, which you've spoken about, and then Gaurang has also come out with his own statement, has been about a personal issue. So just talk to us about this. Sexual harassment, sexual abuse, is it a workplace issue, or is it also at home? Is it also in other relationships?
I think it's everywhere. I know so many girls who are working so hard. They're very successful. Yet in their personal space, I think they're still dealing with men who are abusive, who don't think anything of them, who always have this superior complex, or they feel that women are, you know, it's okay to treat somebody you love in the worst of ways, and they don't even realize the kind of emotional and mental damage they do in the bargain. Because you know, when somebody you love says very hurtful things, they don't leave you for a very, very long time. And also in my case, if I talk about, there was no apology, there is going to be no apology, because of course you know, it's as if nothing happened. And I've just tried so hard to heal. And you know, today, because of this Me Too movement, when I have people, because way back then when I did the FIR at the, you know, when that incident happened, because I was new, everybody, you know, pointed fingers at me, nobody believed me, I lost work. Today, at least people believe. Just the fact that I've been saying the truth, I put out pictures to prove myself, and I'm still fighting in court, but just the fact that today people are not looking at me with doubt, they're supporting me, they're saying, okay, come out, speak up, because, you know, any kind of abuse does a lot of damage. And our country still has a lot, I mean, yes, women are strong in this, speaking about, you know, harassment at workplace, but there, we know women who've suffered domestic violence for the longest time.
Okay.
I think this is a movement that's going to give strength to a lot of women in different spaces, personal and professional.
Okay, I'm just going to turn to Geeta in a minute. By the way, you know, so Gaurang has responded in terms of fairness. You said, he said, there you go, Flora Saini victimizes me, put false allegations, gain publicity on my name. Brutal and cheap, but I'm God-blessed child. After all these proofs, all my loved ones to support me and protest against this, Jai Mata Di. That essentially was his response, if I that's a Facebook yes. post. Your response to that?
Yes. So I would like to maybe say that I have... Sorry.
Carry on, Flora.
I would like to say that today I did go to Sinta's office. I have sought their help. I have also filed a defamation against Mr. Gaurang Doshi today, because this is enough. 2007 say he has maligned my reputation like anything. And you know, when there are three cases already running in the court, what are you saying? What are you saying? You know there are three cases, which is a matter of public record in the Mumbai court's website. How can you just say you are innocent? You're not. The cases are still in court. I went to Sinta today. I have furnished my letter okay. telling them about the facts of the case. And I have also filed a defamation against him today.
All right. Fine. So that's an update on that. That's happening. We will be getting Sushant Singh of Sinta, who's obviously got a lot on his hands, because yes. just today we also had a Loknath filing a defamation case against Vinta. So there's a lot that's happening. I'm just trying to, again, as I'm saying, I'm trying to figure out a lot of the gray lines and trying to help people understand how they should deal with it. Geeta, if I could just ask you, and let's just try and get some, you know, legal advice for anybody who's slightly confused out here. We are hearing two slightly different sorts of issues. One, the sort of issues that we've been hearing in workplace-related ones, which are some of the journalists, MJ Akbar, for example, others are all workplace-related. A person in a position of authority at the work is harassing the person, and that's one set of issues. What Flora is describing is more of a in a relationship, an act of violence. Both wrong. Are there different guidelines and different ways in which both of these should be seen? Different laws, perhaps, you know, Vishaka in one case, domestic, you know, abuse laws in another case. Just help us understand how all of this should be looked at.
Yeah. So the two are totally different. One is domestic violence, and it's protection of women from domestic violence. In India is gender sensitive. In the UK, US is gender neutral. So anyone could, any of the spouses or live-in relationship, any of the partners could file for domestic violence. And it's a civil offense. Unless there's an injunction order and you violate it, then it becomes a criminal. You can make it into a cognizable case. But otherwise, it's a civil offense and you get compensation. It could be sexual violence. It could be mental violence. It could be physical violence. It could be economic violence. So these are the four heads in which violence comes. And this is domestic violence, and the act came in 2005, came into force in 2006. Now you come to the harassment in the workplace. Now that, in fact, is what the Me Too movement started about, that a person in a position of authority or power misuses that position of authority and power and therefore asks for sexual favors. That's essentially an offense or an enactment which came into being in 2013. Before that, with the international convention saying there should right. be no sexual discrimination against women, CEDAW, what happened was that the Supreme Court took note of Vishaka's case in 1996 and laid down broad guidelines.
So two slightly different guidelines. Sandhya, before I welcome, I'm going to go across to Sushant in a minute. Just want to, Sandhya, just to understand this, slightly different in some cases, of course, it could possibly also merge. You could be, this is where the question will come, is it a personal matter, is it a personal relationship? What about relationships between two colleagues who are, it may have been a consensual relationship at a point, then either violence came in, as in Flora's case, or, you know, they wanted to break up, but then pressure was put, and that became a workplace issue. So these are some of the potential gray areas that we're going to have to navigate. Sandhya?
Yeah, this is a tough one, especially if there's a lack of a power equation. For instance, if it's not a boss and you know, a subordinate relationship, in which case that straight away creates a hostile work environment. If it's just two colleagues, then the complaints are he said, she said, and there's really no going further from there unless someone lodges a formal complaint. And this is why we've been urging, and I think this is important, that it shouldn't limit itself. What Me Too is right now shouldn't limit itself to Twitter or social media. That all of us are urging, go ahead and make those complaints to a commission if you want action taken.
And I think that's important, Sandhya.
With an apology, but these.
Yeah, I think it's important, and I think some of what is happening now, because at the end of the day, naming and shaming on social media will take you so far. At the end of the day, there has to be a certain element of due process that has to kick in, so that actually people can be brought to book. And Sandhya, just bear with me for a second. I want to come back to you on that theme. Flora, I just wanted to ask you before I go across to Sushant Singh, who's also with us now. Flora, I just wanted to ask you. I'm sure there are a lot of people whom you've been talking to in the last few days and weeks who'd say, well, okay, this was a domestic relationship, and therefore, does it fall into sexual harassment, or is it, you know, a domestic issue between two people who were in a consensual relationship? Where do you think the difference would lie? And do you think, because there are others who would say that in your case, you may well have felt that he could potentially have had an impact on your career as well. So that's where the lines got blurred.
Sorry, come again? The last part?
Yeah, I mean, could it also be argued that in your case, you felt that, was it ever a factor for you that maybe whatever is happening between you and him could have affected your career?
Unfortunately, we're both in the same industry, and he was a powerful man. And you know, there was another panel discussion where we were talking about the same thing. And see, the abuse in my relationship, I say in any relationship, is not done, because and there's a certain pattern to it. Because today, when he stands and says, "Ki, you know, she's doing it for publicity and all," we don't realize that men like him, men in power, they choose girls like us who are new, who are scared, who they know will not, you know, raise their voice against them. And they pick on girls like that because violence. If you don't like me, I mean, you can just chuck me out of the house. I was living in with you in your house. There was no reason for you to assault me again and again, and that night to assault me that badly. And if I was not leaving your house, you could have called the cops on me. You never did that. I had to file a complaint. I had to go through, you know, all of that, and shaming, and saying that, you know, for publicity with a broken jaw. And also he had told me that I'll see to it how you get work. So it is a kind of, you know, in my case, it is just a very thin line. It was something personal, but because we were in the same profession, it also kind of harmed me that way.
I think, thanks, Rora. I think you made some really, really important points out there. So therefore, it's not just a boss and a subordinate. Sometimes
yes.
You could be colleagues.
That's right.
Sometimes you could have a person or in a position of power. Sometimes it may even be consensual, but it may still, you know, have issues around it. Bachi Karkaria, MK Venu, just want to turn to looking at some of the stories that have also come out in the media. Now, one case, of course, Bachi is a huge elephant in the room out there. We're still waiting for him to return and to see what, if anything, the government is going to do in his case. Was a lot of this happening, Bachi? And I'm just going to take you back maybe, you know, 15, 20, 25 years as you were starting off as a female journalist. Yes, it was a male-dominated society, male-dominated profession to some extent. A certain boys' club may have been there. Was the harassment widespread or no?
Vikram, just to correct you, not 25 years, coming on to almost 40. And I might tell you that I started with Khushwant Singh, who was publicly proclaimed himself as the dirty old man. But it was a very, very safe environment in the Illustrated Weekly when I was working over there. So let me put that there.
Okay.
And Akbar, who you haven't named, was there as a trainee.
I did name him actually, but anyway, carry on.
Okay. And but I want, yes, certainly it was happening. It has happened, you know, in the case of Sonora Jha, who was working with me when we were at the Times of India in Bangalore. And let me tell you that yes, it was happening, and you talked about Boys Club earlier. That certainly had a big impact on why people were not speaking out, and why it continued with such impunity.
Okay.
Because, you know, it was all really down the line that, okay, you know, I'll protect my own and you can say what you want.
Okay.
Also, you but must yeah, remember gonna pause that we you. Did not...
But yeah, sorry, yes. sorry to interrupt you, but yeah, I'm yes. just going to pause you for a okay. minute, because we've just got Sushant Singh and it's not a very stable line. So I'm just going to try and get, you know, talk to him for a minute or two. Then I'm going to come back to this, you and Venu. Mr. Sushant Singh, thanks so much for joining us. Just wanted to understand, now you and Sinta have expressed a lot of concern about some of what is coming out in the film industry. Flora was just telling us she's also been at Sinta and has filed a complaint. What is the status of what is happening? And especially in the case of the Sanskari actor.
Yeah, we've received by today we've received three complaints now, starting from Tanushri, then Vinta was a complaint we took cognizance of through social media reports, and then today Flora visited the office with her problem, and. We are pretty serious. It doesn't matter whether it was a domestic violence case. Violence is violence. Sexual abuse is abuse. Flora is facing some problems. So I just want to assure her that, Flora, we've got your back. And we'll do whatever needs to be done so that your voice is heard. In Tanushri case, police investigation has started. We are cooperating with the police. We've submitted the original case file to the police. So I think now we can't do an inquiry, because since the police has already started the investigation. Regarding Vintananda's case, a show cause notice has been sent to Mr. Aloknath, and in past 2-3 days several more stories have cropped up. So now we will, as per our laws and rules, we have to wait for his reply to our show cause notice, and then we'll take the call.
So just to understand this, Sushant, you're saying you're going to be backing the people who are coming to you with complaints, including Flora and Vinta and others. And he's, of course, now filed defamation cases against Vinta and against others. But this is something which you are giving a categorical assurance you will see through.
Yes. See, because as I think I was just trying to follow the program earlier, you were about this thing that some allegations might just be allegations. Some people might try to hijack this platform, this movement of Me Too, and you know, settle scores. That might happen, but what I'm seeing on social media is that the serious people with real stories and their supporters, they're rebuking the people who are trying to dilute this movement. So yeah, it's not just, you know, everybody's not going through in a wave where they're believing every story, every account.
Flora, are you reassured by that, or at the end of the day, I mean, let's face it, there are lots of powerful people in every industry, and the stories around, we keep wondering as to where all the dirt is going to come out from in the film industry. You hear stories, of every industry, frankly, and film industry, perhaps because it's so glamorous, so many people, you know, powerful people there, well-known people, a lot of blurring between consensual and non-consensual. Do you think there's a lot more still to come? And are you reassured by what Sushant Singh just said?
I do think there's a lot more that is yet to come out, and not just women alone. I think there are men also who would be speaking out. I have a very strong feeling about that. There's another thing that today, you know, when I went to the office of Sinta, I told them 2007 was a completely different scene altogether, and I don't think I would have even thought of going to Sinta. Kind of, I don't know, that feeling behind the back of my head that nobody will listen to me, even though I'm a life member. I never approach them. Today, when I see all that Sinta's doing and the way they're backing the other girls, that gave me strength. And they asked me today, why did you take so long? I said, because I don't know, I never thought about you. I never thought that my people, I'm a member of this association, they would back me up, because it is the same industry. And I just thought I had to go out and fight my battle legally. But today, I feel if I'm you guys are, you know, treating us women like family, and that's one of the best things that happened. Why just Cinta, the Producers Association, I think they have come together and they are writing down some laws, Aamir Khan and, you know, all these guys. I've been very fortunate to work with some very good production houses, that's XL, Farhan Akhtar, Nitesh Sidwani and Ekta Kapoor, who put banners all around the set, and this is some 2 months back, saying that this is a woman work safe environment and please speak up against sexual harassment. Beautiful. How lovely is that?
All right, Farah, as I said, you know, part of what we're going to try and what we should try and do is try and make sure that every organization, every industry starts to think along those lines. I'm going to get Venu in on this note. I guess this question, Venu, so there are two questions that we're going to be keeping on coming up. Number one is going to be this entire issue, and it happens in all laws, that there are going to be people who will misuse the law. We've, by the way, already seen this starting to happen, even with the Me Too campaign, at least some of the allegations seem, you know, crazy. There's one person making allegations who's also tweeting on a hourly basis that she's being poisoned by people in Lodhi Garden. So, you know, there are some of these are prima facie somewhat dodgy. Siddharth had his accusation and his allegation at The Wire, which again he said he's not really sure. How are you going to navigate these particular waters?
See, as far as you know, if an industry is unorganized, I mean, media, of course, is organized. For instance, the film industry people were saying that they are not organized. But these production houses, I wonder whether they have an internal complaints committee. I mean, this is an association which Sushant is talking about on behalf of the association. Some redressal is being undertaken. But is there an institutionalized redressal mechanism, even, say, in the film industry and in the media? Media, also, there are a lot of unorganized, large parts of media are unorganized. So, for instance, The Wire, we are just 3.5 years old, so we set up an internal complaints committee at the beginning. And we even had a senior lawyer come and brief our entire organization on do's and don'ts.
That's important. You have to have a Vishakha committee, and you should, in fact, I'm going to just go across
so
because the
I just want to add, whether it's in a corporate organized setup or whether it's outside, there's one common thing to all, which you started with, what is common to all these occurrences, which is the personal space of a woman, her bodily integrity and autonomy is violated. If that is violated, then these things should kick in, and this Menaka Gandhi committee provides a good breakthrough for something that is happening outside of the office, which, you know, if a person from the outside says that, has a complaint about somebody in The Wire, the internal complaints committee does not have the jurisdiction. So this, I think this Menaka Gandhi committee will have jurisdiction. I think it's a good idea.
So you should have internal committees, Vishakha committees and external committees to whom things can be taken. That's a good idea. But Chikarkari, I just wanted to ask you, and then I'm going to go back to Sandhya. There are some industries, of course, where, and perhaps it's not entirely a surprise that a lot of what is coming out is in areas like Bollywood and media and, you know, journalism, and I'm sure it happens elsewhere also, and I'm sure it's all going to start coming out one by one. But I guess some of the possible risks for female journalists are particularly high because, as we've heard from some of these stories, female journalists quite often have to go out, they have to interview people, they have to, you know, interact with a lot of people. So potentially the number of opportunities when something can happen is high. You know, you were at your career, began your career roughly the same time as my mom did, and, you know, also in the same field. So, yeah,
I'm not going to go along with you in this, because I think women are perfectly, I mean, as in any profession, they go out, they do their job. And I think this kind of argument may well be used to stop women from getting the kind of assignments that they have fought very hard to get. You know, it was in the old days that, you know, women can't do women the night shift and we are worried about you.
So you and many other women showed that there's a place for women everywhere. I think the point I'm trying to make is that the rules and the guidelines. So what would be your advice to young female journalists, for example? Obviously, they should be there. And journalism is a perfect example of an industry which began as being male dominated and today is female dominated. Look at a large number of journalist organizations, including, you know, NDTV. They are all dominated by women. So it is an area where women have made a place for themselves. And that's despite the fact that it was potentially a business where people would have said, you know, is this something which girls should be doing, going out in the field? and so on and so forth. What's the advice you would give to young women journalists?
Vikram, I would say not only to those who are going outside, but very much about what is happening inside, which is what the Me Too debate is all about, that, you know, please be very cautious and conscious about your own space, that they are. Today's journalists are very, very, very conscious about the violations to their bodies, much, much more than it was in my time, where a lot of things were taken for granted that, oh, this is what happens. Today, no young journalist thinks that way. So I don't think you really need to give them any advice of that kind. What you have to tell them is that, yes, speak up, because you will not be shamed. And Me Too has, if it's done anything, it's that it has turned the spotlight away, it's turned the shame factor, the stigma away from the woman and onto the perpetrator, which is the whole problem even with rape. You know, that it was completely wrong that the entire stigma was attached to women. So what Me Too has done is to open up the issue, to open the doors for redress to happen. Okay. And I think that's what is really important, that I would say speak up, because in my time, a lot of women, and I will tell you the one case, the really the only case where I was personally involved, I heard a lot of the stories about the other editors who have been talked about, but I was not in any position or even in the same organization when these things happened. But what did happen to us in Bangalore, Sonora's case, where Sonora came to me purely as a friend, because I was not really officially her boss, and she did not wanted to be taken up, because she was very sensitive about the fact that she was the one who would get riled and abused and suffer professionally and personally. And therefore, even when I did write a column, I decided that I had to write that column. I did not name names, only because the person concerned, that is Sonora herself, did not want to be put into that kind of position.
And I think at the end of the day, you do have to respect that. You can't, it has to be the woman's choice at the end of the day. If she does not want to be named, she does not want something to be done.
But today, I don't think today, Vikram, I think there will be very few women.
They would all want to speak up. Yeah, and that's a change that has happened.
Because the whole atmosphere has changed.
I agree with you.
And that's the wonderful thing that has happened.
Sandhya, time does move on. So that perhaps is an important landmark. And Sandhya, to that extent, I do think the genie is out of the bottle. I don't think it's going to be put back. And I do believe that whatever has happened in the last 2-3 weeks is a turning point, because I don't think people in position of power are going to be as complacent as they have been. That I can behave in a certain manner and it's not going to come out, and everyone's going to be too scared to speak out. I think that's over. And I think you and others like you have really helped in uncorking the bottle, and that genie is out. Sandhya, from now onwards, do you think people will be able to speak, will be empowered to speak?
I think so, but I'm just going to go back to what Ms. Karkaya said a little bit earlier, that the shame is not on us anymore. I'd say 50-50, because my DMs on Twitter are full of women with just two emotions, guilt and fear. So guilt and shame, I'm clubbing in one, and fear, because they're afraid. I've had women tell me my in-laws are Orthodox, so I can't come out in the open. There are women telling me, if this comes out, everyone's going to turn around and ask me, why were you there? My Twitter timeline is full, not just mine. Everyone's timeline is full of men asking, why were you there? Ms. Tavleen Singh earlier today said, why did you go to that gentleman's house? We're still being asked, why were we there? Why were we drinking? Why were we wearing what we were wearing? So the shame is still on us. But I think there's that entire other 50% where we're saying, I believe you. I see the risks in a blanket, I believe you. Believe me, I do. I'm trying to come from a balanced place as much as possible. But to a true, to a story, to a person that has a true survivor story to narrate, those three words are magical. And I think that's proving to be the one thing that's allowing a lot of us to come forward and speak and say, you know, this happened to me as well. And so, yes, I think a lot more women are going to be empowered, because A, there's a platform now. and B, if we guide it in the direction of due process. And I stand by due process.
Okay, eventually, so that's due process, is something that is important. You agree with that, right? That at the end of the day, this has been an important step in a cathartic moment where people have been speaking. But just saying naming and shaming, because naming and shaming by itself is something that is potentially prone to a lot of abuse, right, at some point or the other.
Yes.
More than going to the lawyer. So due process at some point now has to start kicking in.
Yes. So I think, as has been said by Bachi and the others, the environment has changed. And it's really that. So there were provisions in place. There was the internal committee. That internal committee is not an internal committee. It's okay. A committee with external experts. So what is being stated is there will be a majority of women, there will be external experts, and so it's really not an internal committee. It's a committee in place so that you can complain there. I don't think Mrs. Gandhi's committee may really help so much, because it seems an extra legal committee which is...
I actually would now just like to turn my attention to this a little bit. We've covered a lot of the ground as to what should happen, what's going forward. Let's just turn a little bit to the corporate world, which is really where a lot of this started from, you know, the Me Too campaign, harassment at the workplace. Who better to talk about it than Indra Jaisingh, who's now joining us, probably one of the top legal minds, done a lot of work on this entire issue. Indra Jaisingh, thank you so much for joining us. I just wanted to first of all start off by getting you to help us understand what exactly is it, because we are seeing lots of things getting blurred even now. There's still confusion in many of the gray areas. What actually constitutes sexual harassment at the workplace? What can companies do to fight it?
To begin with, we are talking about sexual harassment at the workplace. So let's not mix it up with sexual harassment, which also happens outside workplaces, for example, in other public places, like in public transport, on the streets, etc., etc. So we're talking about a very specific phenomenon where there is a hierarchical relationship between the person harassing and the person harassed. But it would also be, that would be sexual harassment. It could be verbal, it could be tactile, it could be physical, but it is not necessarily, sexual abuse, which is a crime. Now, sexual harassment is also a crime, but the emphasis is on the word harassment. So it becomes harassment when there is a pattern to it, when it's repetitive, when you face it at the workplace, it's harassment. You can also have sexual abuse at the workplace. You can also have rape at the workplace. So it's a range of behavior which is sexual in nature. But all of it is covered, but by different laws.
Right. And I think that helps in clarification. Now, I'm going to actually ask you a question, which, to be honest, you'll be surprised at how many people have asked me this question in the last week or so. So I just want to get you on the specific legal position. People have asked me, what happens if I have a colleague whom I'm a friend with? What happens if we decide to go out and have a drink, go out and have coffee? What about interpersonal, what about relationships at the workplace? What is right and what is wrong in this? Let me just get the view straight from you.
See, this is how it works. The point is, because there is a hierarchy within the workplace, it becomes the duty of the supervisor. Let's say a co-worker harasses another worker, but the question there would be, what was the supervisor doing while all this was going on? So you cannot get away from the fact that there is a chain of command, there is a hierarchy, and it's the point is, the buck has to stop somewhere, and what it means is someone has to take responsibility for what's going on at the workplace, and the chain of command goes, I would say, right up to the top. So, for example, the board of directors of a company would ultimately be responsible for workplace harassment, whether it's by a co-worker or whether it's by a harasser, because this is what is known as part of the duties of the employer to stop harassment at the workplace. So it's not whether it's a co-worker or whether it's a supervisor or whether it's an editor. the point is, no person can sexually harass a woman at the workplace for the reason that it interferes with her fundamental right to work.
Right. Again, I think that helps bring a certain amount of clarity. Just want to ask one more question, which is that from a company's point of view, many in management would be asking, look, what specifically is it that we can do and what we can do? For example, a company may say, we can't guarantee that any one of our employees, we are a company with 30,000 employees, how do we guarantee that somebody is not harassing someone else? How do we make sure that that doesn't happen? So from a company's point of view, I guess you can, of course, have Vishakha guidelines, make sure that that reporting takes place. What else is it that a company should be enforcing to make sure that it is compliant, that it's doing the right thing?
The primary duty is this, the laying down of the policy and the monitoring of that policy. So, for example, an employer cannot say that, look, I was not aware of the fact that my supervisor was harassing somebody working under him. It is the duty of the board of directors to be aware of the fact that their supervisor is harassing somebody who works under them. Now, if you apply this to an editor, obviously the duty of the board of directors is to make sure that the editor they employ doesn't harass a co-worker or anybody working under them. But what does this mean? It means constant awareness. It means constant monitoring. It means doing an audit of sexual harassment at the workplace periodically by the top management. That apart, it means periodic training of all their staff to make them aware of the fact that if you so much as dare to do this, there is a law to take care of you. And the law is your contract of employment. So the contract of employment can be terminated because the Supreme Court has said very clearly that this is an act of misconduct. Then, of course, the ultimate duty of the employer is to ensure a safe working environment, which means they have to make sure that you don't have this obscene kind of water cooler talk going on in the establishment. People are not talking over each other's heads and exchanging obscenities. It creates what we call a hostile work environment. So if you look at it very carefully, there are several duties before you get to the stage of a complaint being made.
All right. Indra Jaisingh, thank you so much for joining us. I think that's really brilliant legal advice. I think all companies should record what she has just said, play it back to yourselves in boardrooms, in every meeting that you're having. Try and apply all of that. You'll be a better place. I'm going to get just a second or two to help how it can be put into practice. Shushant Singh, I do have you back before we lose the line again. Just wanted to very quickly ask you. The film industry is one where there are lots of close relations, where there are people, where there's a possibility of consensual relationships also. How are you going to deal with it's possible that other charges will come up. It's possible that the response will be, yes, this was consensual. What was the harm in it?
Yep, tough question, very gray area, but let me give you my perspective on this. In last couple of days, my worldview has totally changed. It's shaken. I also used to think, you know, a lot of consensual things happen. Yes, when you're on film sets, outdoor shoots, a lot of it happens. But in the beginning of your career, what I used to think that, okay, so somebody said, you'll get a role if you sleep with me, and the girl sleeps, then she's made a choice. But no. In almost every industry, the patriarchal system has created a space where the choice has been taken away. If a woman has always dreamed of becoming an actress, becoming a heroine, and when she lands here and she realizes the only way is that she has to sleep with someone, what is she supposed to do? Kill her dream, go back, or cry for a few nights and then decide, no, my dream is bigger. Maybe I'll hate myself forever after this, but so what? Today I'll sleep, tomorrow when I'm in power, I will not have to. That's what is happening. That is not consensual. That is exploitation, because we've taken away the choice. That's the biggest problem.
I think that's
second
really,
thing, do we even understand? Second thing, do we really understand the lives of women? I thought I was a woke, you know. I knew things. I just read a tweet yesterday. I'm forgetting the name of the lady who tweeted. Two friends meeting for coffee in a city, two well-read friends who are on Twitter, and she asks the other friend, so how did you come? She says, I came by auto. That's the safest, you see. No doors, no locked windows, I can jump out. And suddenly I was woken up that there are predators in the house, yeah. There are predators in the office, there are predators lurking on the street. So a woman's sixth sense, her antenna has to be up 24 hours a day. One eye is always, you know, looking behind her shoulder. Am I safe or not? And in that environment, she has to live. What kind of a tiring life is that? And after that, they work with us. They love us. They are mothers, daughters, sisters. They do so much for us. But at the same time, fearful 24 hours a day. Vikram, you and me, if we had to live with that kind of situation, we would become paranoid in 24 hours. Where we have to be afraid wherever we are,
really well.
How we are sitting, how we are standing, how somebody is staring.
I think you put it really well, Sushant. You put it really well, and I think that's really the thought to take forward from this. That, and I think you've correctly also identified when it is possibly consensual, when it is not. Ashwini, just want to get you, and you've been patiently waiting all this time. In the workspace, similarly, when we were just hearing Indira Jaisingh saying, this is how you sensitize, how tough is that to do in an organization?
No, it's not tough. You see, you have to, like you said, you can't guarantee that it will not happen. But I think your role really is, first of all, to lay down the clear policy for prevention of sexual harassment. In spite of what happened in the Nirbhaya case, and there was a knee-jerk reaction and so much happened. Even today, if you look at it, a lot of companies do not have that policy. The government has said make it mandatory. But what are they doing to make sure that people are really having, companies are having that? I think you need to create awareness. You need to get people to sign declarations that they've read the policy. You need to have a time-bound mechanism to get over with these cases. But I just want to make another point, which I think I've heard everybody talk about this. We are right now, really, it's just the tip of the iceberg. I will still not call this a movement. I will call it a moment, and I hope it doesn't end up with a knee-jerk reaction. Because even that, we've seen earlier as well. Today, you look at various reports, whether it's the World Economic Forum report, whether it's the World Bank report, India is considered one of the most dangerous places for women to be in. India,
okay.
And the government will come out with this policy, but I think we need to have a mechanism to make sure it is being followed.
Okay.
We need to have gender audits across.
Don't allow Me Too to become a movement. Keep it as a movement. All right, I'm nearly out of time on the program, and I promise I'd give you some time. Quickly, some show of hands. Lady there, yeah.
Hello, everyone. Basically, I just want to say that we live in a country where the days have come where we are worshipping the women. And it is the same country where the days are there, we treat women as an object. Means harassment is everywhere. Either it is a home or it's a workplace, corporate world or film industry.
Let me just get another couple of ladies to have their say down there. Yeah.
I have a question, actually. With reference to the unorganized work sector, for example, house helps who work in houses, they do not even have access to the internet. So how can the Me Too movement become more inclusive and not just a social media paradigm altogether?
Okay, fine. The lady out there, yeah.
Yeah, one question I'm having, that what about those harassment cases which one has no proof to speak up? How one can speak up about those cases which one has no proof about them?
Okay, what happens when there's no proof? Okay, last comment from the lady out there. I'm already over on the program.
Hello, everyone. The nation definitely wants the movement to go beyond the media and entertainment industry. But when it is taking so long for the technology savvy and empowered woman, so how long will it take for the rural India to come out?
Okay, you know something, I'm going to just end this program because we are out of time right now. I'm going to try and get some more comments from people out here. We are out of time, but I think she's just touched on something which, quite frankly, we should walk away from here thinking about. Yes, a lot of the women who have spoken are people who do have a voice. They can come on social media, they can tweet, they have ways of getting their voice out. If you actually think about what must be happening in other parts, in small towns, in rural India, I'm sure there are lots of really, really horrible stories that are coming out. So, yes, I think we need to take this as from a moment into a movement and try and make sure that we give women in this country the status that they deserve, a workplace that they deserve, and at the very minimum, not have issues like the abuse that we have seen in so many of these cases. That's a big fight. We'll be back next week.